Good evening, and welcome to this evening conversation with two formidable personalities in the field of business and policy. We are joined by Dr. Rajiv Kumar, who has on September 1st taken over as the chief of Niti Aayog. For the uninitiated, Niti Aayog is India's premier policy thinking institution, which is tasked with transforming India and works on planning for India's medium and long-term growth. They, of course, have to keep fighting fires along the way. Dr. Rajiv Kumar is an economist, a PhD twice over, has headed policy think tanks, has worked in multilateral institutions, and has advised many private sector companies as well. With him, we have Mr. Ajay Banga, who's the global head of Mastercard. He is no stranger to India.
Who doesn't have a PhD?
Not even one. But he has been to Stephens, and that counts for something. And he's also recently incubated the Strategic Partnership Forum, the U.S.-India Strategic Partnership Forum, which of course is partnering with CyFy, and he is also there. He's also here in that capacity. So thank you for joining us this afternoon. We are going to have maybe 15 to 20 minutes of conversations with the two gentlemen, and then we're going to bring some of you in. And we are going to go right to the point. We are going to be talking about digital economy because this is the digital conference. We have heard the minister yesterday speak about the exponential growth in digital transactions. I was reading a report this morning that last month itself has seen a huge jump on the UPI interface. And I think it was the number was 5,000 crores. But there are some estimates which peg the digital payments ecosystem space itself at close to $500 billion over the next 3 to 5 years, and the digital economy at close to $1 trillion. So we are talking about the digital economy and the digital payments ecosystem with the two gentlemen. I will pose my first question to Dr. Rajiv Kumar. Sir, traditional banks, the bricks and mortar banks in India, have an expansive and a sophisticated regulatory blanket around them. Much of their protection stems from the belief in India that custodians of public money require layers of security and accountability. Why should we not have the same regulatory goalposts for digital payments, wallets, and banks?
Samir, first and foremost, great pleasure to be here. And thanks for inviting me to this to the conference. I think my first conference appearance since I've taken over. So that's that. The question, you know, my own understanding of the regulatory system for the banks, et cetera, is that, and I, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we are over-regulated. Mm. And there is a lot of micro-regulation, there's far too much of micro-management, as it were, almost, of the Indian banking and Indian capital sector as a whole. And there is, therefore, but on the other hand, there cannot, of course, be any free for all in this sector, because you know, as far as finance and household savings are concerned, you've got to protect the saver, you've got to protect the consumer. So I think you need to find a sort of a happy balance between the two. And I think to that extent, when you talk digital, and when you talk digital payment, cash, etc., I think there is a strong need here for what I would call self-regulation. And I think it'll be that is the key going forward, because unless we do that, then the tendency is always for the regulator to become overbearing. And I've been sort of suggesting this for some time, which is that all the players in the digital world today, it'll be very useful for them to set up what are called the self-regulating organizations. And the sooner they do that, and maybe led by the NIPC perhaps. That could be one of the agencies to lead them, but the sooner they do that, the better off would be, because otherwise, God forbid the day when you get one scam or the other, then the regulatory arm of the government would come down very heavily, and that might just see the sector not growing as rapidly and as well as it should go. Just one other thing is that I'm not so sure whether the regulator, in this case, I suppose the RBI, is yet ready or equipped to get digital payments in some sense on board and understand the system as to what sort of regulation may be required, which is different, which would be different from the prudential and other norms that you require for the brick and mortar banks. So therefore, I think there is also need now for the RBI to interact far more closely with the industry. And having been on the RBI board, I can say that this is something that is now needed. And the sooner we get that on, the better off we are.
Thanks. Mr. Banga, since you are from the industry, let me pose the same question to you. And I think Dr. Kumar has suggested a self-regulatory mechanism or an arrangement amongst service providers or a conversation with the key stakeholders as being perhaps the more optimum way of discovering codes, standards, benchmarks, practices. Since you've been in the space and you've been studying the space for a while, do you think that's something that is doable and desirable?
Actually, I was going to applaud his approach. It's rare that you find somebody in a policy-making position of that quality to actually say what he just said. And I think we should encourage him, because I'm not saying there should be no regulation. Mm. I think what he's saying is you create a framework, guidelines, guide rails, but allow the industry and its bodies to create the right framework within that. Standard setting is the single most important thing that industry can do in an effort to create a infrastructure that's the right foundation. You know, think about electrical plugs. If every electrical plug was a different kind of fitting, you would have no standards. But think about rail lines, the old meter gauge and broad gauge. If you have separate rail lines, there is no standard. It's the same for digital payments. We talk about digital as a foreign idea or a new idea whose time has come. Digital is one more technology that helps to democratize the process of access for people. So standards that are driven and written by ecosystem players is what's needed. I'll give you a real life example from our old card payment business. A lot of people, by the way, think we issue cards. We don't. Banks issue cards. We're just the infrastructure of technology and data. And whether it's a card or a fingerprint or a phone or a, you know, tomorrow I look at him and I transfer money because we bump a chip with each other. I'm indifferent to that point. My point's not that. My point is, in the card industry, there are standard setting bodies that decide how the chip should work. So the chip works in a particular way, so terminals can be standardized.
It works everywhere.
Global standards on these kinds of things are really useful, and I'm actually really pleased to hear that comment.
So can I just take this conversation a little further? So many have also argued that the digital ecosystem that we are creating, including the payment space, including some of your social transfer schemes and processes, are all exportables from India to the world. So is it also incumbent on us, in a sense in India, to discover the correct standards, protocols, and inclusive methods, which can then be used by many of our neighbors? Many of our own provinces, of course, will be beneficiaries first, which are currently outside the mainstream, but many other countries are also looking for these same similar solutions. So is there a global economic diplomacy aspect or a global economic responsibility aspect as well?
I don't think that can be an explicit objective of policy, because from where I can see, the most important policy objective would be to get it right within the country. Mm-hmm. You know, in the sense, you know, and if we get that right in the country, and if you know, then you know, if others start using, that's a very strong positive externality. But I don't think the word that you used about global economic responsibility or global digital responsibility is the game that we want to get into, because I think it's complicated enough to get it right here. And because, you know, and also the fact that what we do want to do is to perhaps, you know, look at the gen next within for ourselves. So mm-hmm. not just be always followers to what's happening abroad and, you know, and then follow that. But given that we are quite a IT and software, you know, powerhouse, mm-hmm. then can we ourselves devise technologies and methods and digital payment methods, etc., which are in some sense even more advanced, you know, than what you have abroad. And if we aim for those, and if we get those right here,
then they themselves would be attractive
and be more amenable to others. And you know, and who knows? I mean, you see, because very often when we, as you yourself implied in some sense, you know, that, oh, our neighboring countries and African countries would then follow us. No, I think Europe should follow us after a while. And why not? You see, because there are certain things that we are doing the way we are doing, where our digital payment system can be far more, you know, disaggregated and, you know, and useful for the, you know, very, very small entrepreneurs, etc. And if we get that right, given our scale, which is enormous, if we can get that right, if we can get the digital footprint and payment footprint down to our villages, then I don't see why
we have a solution for the world.
We have a solution for the world, and not just
I can actually give you a tangible example. QR codes. Bharat QR and QR codes here are standardized in India by all the players, the infrastructure players. We've agreed on a methodology to make it work. It started here. Hopefully, over the next 2 or 3 years, it will vastly expand the acceptance of digital payments among the merchant community. There are 60 million merchants in India. 2.5 million of them today accept electronic payments. So our gap in India between what could happen versus where we are today, one of the ways of bridging it is with low-cost terminals. Terminals are expensive.
That's right.
Expensive to buy, expensive to maintain, need a landline, need to be maintained on a monthly basis. If you're in a village 28 kilometers from the nearest maintenance guy, nobody will go. QR codes need no maintenance. So in so many ways, QR codes are a solution for a real challenge. Guess what's happening now? We're using the same thing in countries in Africa. That's obvious, but guess what I'm trying to do with it? Put it into the United States. Yeah. Because to me, in the US, while there are 8 million merchants accepting electronic payments today, there are at least another 3 to 4 million who could be brought into the system with QR codes as a way of preference to enact. So I actually am a believer that this idea of globalization actually works through both ways.
Yeah.
India's developing stuff. I have 14% of my workforce in this country. And they're not doing back office call center stuff. They're doing mobile technology and cybersecurity development for the world. I'm launching electronic digital wallets around the world being built in Pune and Vadodara. So, India's confidence of what it can achieve should be of let's develop it, let's make it work in India, mm-hmm. and then let the market suck it up, because that's the way it'll happen.
And if you get the robustness that India needs, because that's what India needs, you know.
That's right.
So, you know, that's then should be, you know, it's attractive for the whole world, you know.
Mr. Banga, since you have been in this space for a while and you have been managing technology and data that allows money to move, which area of concerns do you see with this emerging digital payment security framework in India? Do you see this largely as a supply side issue, better protocols and standards like you mentioned, or do you also see consumer awareness and consumer behavior as something that needs to be worked on?
Listen, cybersecurity is the one thing that keeps me up at night. And I've been saying this, if you put a Google me on this topic, you'll find me as the guy who's been talking about this for a year or two. My worst nightmares are coming true with things like the Equifax data breach in the United States a few weeks ago. I'll tell you why I feel this way. I served on the Presidential Commission for Cybersecurity, and we produced a report that has got a relatively tangible set of recommendations. Firstly, to answer your question, it is a combination of the weakest link being gullible. Mm-hmm. So what's that? That's you and me as a consumer, and it's also a small merchant. You know, take a dentist or a school with which you make electronic payments. If you think the dentist is spending any money on securing their payment system or their computer, you're mistaken.
Yeah.
And you add to that the fact that consumers seem to prefer convenience over security. They take security as given for granted from the company they're interacting with. That combination, combined with the Internet of Things, with 50 billion connected devices in the next 7 or 8 years, the amount of data we are talking about that's going to be flowing around, and the weaknesses of single points of concentration of that data, that combination to me is quite frightening. So it's both a consumer knowledge and SME knowledge situation. It's also for the supply side, just to make you also have a few sleepless nights with me, of the 50 billion devices that people say will be available in a few years, today's number is 7.
Mm-hmm.
Those 7 billion devices do not have a standard, back to Dr. Rajiv's point, do not have a standard today of how they can be tracked individually. Therefore, you don't have critical IP addresses for each device. You cannot download improvements. Today on your phone, you download a new iOS update, and you click on it, and you think, okay, I'm protected from the latest weakness that is discovered. That's not true for your video camera that's connected to the internet, or for your refrigerator, or any of these. And therefore, neither can you download patches. There are default passwords and everything. That's how all the recent breaches happened. All the passwords are 0000.
So the IoTs constitute a huge point of vulnerability.
I think there's both a supply side problem and a demand side problem.
You know, I don't so far keep awake at night because I don't understand cybersecurity so much. But you know what keeps me, because
I'm going to help him.
I'm like one of the consumers sort of, that I just use. You know, but what really worries me is our constant underestimation of the Indian people's ability to absorb new technology and their,
ingenuity.
And ingenuity and also their taking to it. In the sense that I just this morning discovered that we are now already passing through 300 gigabytes of data. Mm-hmm. And we have surpassed both China and the US, because of, entry of one or two players. On mobile data, right? Now, why I'm saying that is that, the speed at which the Indians' aspirations and use of digital technology is rising, and the ingenuity in which they will put it to different uses, I think is constantly underestimated. So my worry is always the IT backbone, that we'll never get, we are not getting enough IT backbone in place, and therefore we'll constantly be running, this will
playing
be running,
catch up.
Playing catch up, and that playing catch up in the digital world is extremely expensive. Extremely expensive, extremely frustrating, and can lead to sort of breakdowns, which then would be very difficult to, very difficult to sort of, rectify, as it were. And the second one, which is that about digital cash, I think that we need a lot of effort and awareness, especially in our, in the countryside, where it's still somehow, the digital cash thing is not, is not yet accepted. People still like to feel the money as they're handling. It will happen very quickly, but you need to take it to the tipping point. And that's the big effort that I think the companies need to make at this point of time. Yeah.
Mr. Banga, sorry.
I think he's right, and I think I have a few specific suggestions, unless you want to do that later,
on how we could have a
conversation to take this forward. I think there is, in my mind, on the IT backbone, the stability, the cybersecurity of it, there are three or four things that are relatively short-term in nature that can happen without a great deal of new laws. And the first one is the sharing of information. So my knowledge of these cyber systems is that cybersecurity is, there are two kinds of companies in the world. There are those who think that they've been broken into and know it, and there are those that do not think they've been broken into,
but have been broken into.
And the issue really is, how do you deal with that? And how do you manage that? So you need public and private cooperation before, during, and after a cyber attack. Our systems are not geared for that. And what do I mean by that? Security agencies and the industry, whether it's financial services or medical, pharma, or anybody else, they should be doing joint exercises before now, preparing for what could be the inevitability of it. There's got to be ways to share information so that you can protect each other by virtue of the fact that if you know you're being attacked, people like me might get attacked next.
That's right.
That's not currently how it works. There is another issue, which is the equivalent of a reverse Miranda rights kind of thing, which is if I know something is a weakness in my company,
I
go to my regulator and say, I've got a problem, and they turn around and ding me on my regulatory evaluation, that's not a good way to work.
That's right.
You need to have a safe harbor where I can go to him and say, sir, I think I have a problem. You're a policymaker. Can you help me solve it? And that would be seen as a constructive relationship. So those are things that can happen relatively quickly. There are a few other things, default passwords. I proposed an idea in the Cyber Commission report, which is the equivalent of a food nutrition label. So let me explain what I mean. Today, if you go and buy a food item, and you know you shouldn't have X percentage of trans fats as the nature of your day's requirement, you can read it on a label. How do you know tomorrow that refrigerator is designed with better security than that one? You will not know as a consumer. We need the equivalent of a food nutrition label for cyber security and safety for a consumer to feel confident that when I'm buying that refrigerator, I am paying for X. When I'm buying that one, I'm paying.
So like you have for energy efficiency, like you have for food items. Exactly.
Yeah. We need to do these things. We cannot afford for this discussion to be a five-year conversation. Because to Dr. Rajiv's point, the cost of a mistake in this space is way too high. Catching up is really hard.
Yeah. So, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Niti Aayog is certainly one of the champions and proponents of your institution around the whole, movement to make India a more business-friendly place, the ease of doing business, as it is called. Now, how do we quantify the ease of doing business in the digital ecosystem? Is it the ease of doing transactions? Is it the access to platforms? Is it the access to devices with individuals? Is it the security of the transaction online, and how secure is the larger ecosystem so that businesses feel comfortable? And do you think that the ease of doing business needs to be tweaked or rethought when you see the digital story of India as being central to its larger growth ambitions?
Well, I'm going to be dead honest on this one, which is that we're still grappling with the current ease of doing business and getting India from 146 to the top 100. So we haven't, and once we get there, and I believe the next ease of business rankings are going to be out at the end of this month. So the honest answer is that we haven't thought about the next step about the digital ease of doing business, not as Niti Aayog, because there's a huge agenda before us on the other side. But what I can see is very clearly that for the ease of doing, I think access is going to be the key for the digital payment side. Access and security. I mean, that's very clearly the two which are the key in my, as far as I can make out. And also at that later stage, the networking. That if they are going to be networking in the sense that how many merchants do you get, from 2 million now to 60 million, what is the scale? Because, the effectiveness of the digital would depend upon the size that it has
of
the network. So that, I think those three would, as far as I'm concerned, be the key going
forward.
So
the rate of proliferation, the security of the ecosystem, and access to individuals.
Access to individuals equitably, in the sense that we cannot afford to have another set of divergence, another variable of divergence between different regions of the country or different income classes, etc. So that you must have more BHIMs, and you must have more, sort of RuPay payments, or you must have other, all the other proliferations, so that everybody, and anybody can get access. And the last one is access to digital credit, which is very important, because now I know that there are companies which are making this possible, which are using digital transactions as a history for making the credit. So I think that too will become one of the variables for determining what the ease of doing business in the digital world is.
And let me just quickly ask you one more nuanced question on the point you mentioned. And should government be selecting winners? So because you took a name of a number of instruments which are largely seen as being part of a public sector-led initiative. Do you think government needs to create the market conditions and all players should be competing in that market space? Or do you think because we have to look at the issue of access and equity, there is some role at some stage for government interventions?
Government intervention should come, in my view, only to ensure that you get the right scale. And you get the right scale so that everybody can function here. And I'm not for a minute sort of saying that we need preferred treatment for any, because that then can create a sort of an unlevel playing field. And I think it's the best world is a competitive world where you can. But at the same time, it will be clear that you will have some instruments being put out there by agencies which are government aided or government funded. So to that extent, that's the help that the government should be giving or has been giving to those instruments already.
Ajay, sorry, you wanted to come in.
So my view is that the government's role clearly is to provide the infrastructure of access in the form of, for example, Aadhaar and UPI, to me is an outstanding foundational idea. Now, whether you have only one of those or you have more than one so that you don't have a single fail point. Mm-hmm. Remember, a single fail point is a very critical factor to be thought through. If we're going to make India digital, Can you have all of India's digital relying on one point? That's the thing that needs to be debated in public policy. I don't think the answer is clear. And by the way, nobody knows the answer anywhere in the world because this is a unique experiment.
Indian experiment.
So I think there's a valuable discourse that can happen here. Having said that, the fact that different regions should not have different ways of approaching this, the idea of standards to me, it's not just national standards. I would encourage you to think of global interoperable standards. Because I tell you, if you want to influence the way this grows, you cannot be in a vacuum of your own. You will be interacting with things going in and out. Companies, exports, tourism, people, businesses coming and going. You cannot do this by creating a separate space. You will otherwise end up with the equivalent of what happened in the VHS days of Betamax and VHS. Okay. And that is an expensive mistake to make. So my opinion is the access point government should provide. It's providing infrastructure. It should help with creating the guide rails for that regulatory framework. Inside those guide rails, industry must cooperate as we started out to create its own standards. And with this, you can make a healthy marriage of public sector capability with private sector ingenuity and capital, which I think is what we're kind of...
But you know, an important issue, I mean, I raised those issues because, I mean, inclusion is important. And you cannot have a situation where you have large swaths of population being excluded because they can't afford, you know, the digital.
Affordable access has to be
a government responsibility, and the government must be doing whatever it has to ensure that. I mean, this is like, I mean, you know, this is where you come to the situation where is the digital world a public good or a private good?
Absolutely.
You know, and digital world is a public good, and to that extent, the government has to ensure. You know, that there is optimum delivery of that particular good at price points which are affordable to the common Indian. And if there is a situation where some of the products, you know, some new products need to be brought into the market to ensure that, so be it. But the public good nature of the digital economy has to be assured for the country going forward.
You know, the whole idea of getting access, take a country like Egypt or South Africa or Nigeria, where we're actually working with the government to provide access for social distribution of benefits, but also to create accounts being opened with electronic KYC of identity, so digital identities. We are actually, in the Egyptian government, the digital identity is on even a feature phone, not just a smartphone, kind of like what's happening here.
Yeah.
And then we open an account for them, put a wallet there, all their remittances come in there, they get a virtual card number to shop online, they get connected to a bill payment engine to enable utility payment, school payment without standing in a queue, and they get a card to shop. That vision is not unique to what's going on in India. The manner in which it's being executed in India with biometric identification is unique. But the idea of doing this, in the last 5 years, Mastercard has partnered to deliver 360 million people around the world with a financial transaction account. 360 million. So we can do it. And we can do it at a price point that makes sense. So my point here is, take the best from everybody, steal shamelessly from everybody. The idea is for India to win. And India can win because of the size and scope of the marketplace here. That's what I'm talking about.
So there is one criticism I hear when I travel around the world that the price points in India at which some of these services are being delivered, and I'm actually happy about that, sometimes make it not very attractive for some actors simply because the size of certain services is not enough yet.
See, my view is that's junk and it's whining. You know, and I worked at Nestle for many years. And we launched single serve packets of product.
That's right.
Because the price point was attractive to an Indian consumer. Hindustan Lever launched products in single serves. Yeah. Let a company innovate to meet what the consumer wants. It's not the company's right to give a consumer what they want to give. It's the consumer's right to buy what they want to buy. So this is junk. And anybody who says that to you, you should tell them to go learn.
That you're lazy. Okay. So final question, I think, because we've been discussing this.
But having said that, economic benefits for both sides are very important. Legislating a price that makes it uneconomic for you to get the best of technology.
Is equally counterproductive.
The best of capability is actually worse because you isolate yourself into being satisfied with what may not be the best.
So being in the policy space, I can make a general statement that legislating prices is generally not a good idea.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because they create distortions. So, you know, and the price can be discovered.
And we have seen it in some sectors.
And you've seen it in many sectors. So I think that's what the market can determine for you. In any
so the final question to the two of you before I open it up to two or three of my colleagues who have expressed interest to pose questions to you, is jobs. Mm. Is this the sector which can also respond to India's need to create a million or whatever the number they throw around these days, a million jobs a month or 15 million jobs a year? Do you think the digital economy, the digital ecosystems could produce, could create a whole new cadre of entrepreneurs and professionals?
Well, I mean, the first thing that you must recognize is that there is no trade-off, you know, in this, you know, the new economy and jobs. Mm. So that's the worst thing that can, you know, that's the narrative that we just must junk at this point of time. This is the economy for tomorrow, and I think what you have to figure out is to, you know, where would this create new jobs, and which are the sectors where the new jobs would come. And I'm convinced that these new jobs will come. The thing that government must be doing is to actually looking out for what sort of skills and what sort of upgradation of skills you need in your working force to be able to take advantage of these jobs as they emerge, and not be running behind the curve. And this is where I am now propagating quite intensively a much huge expansion of our apprenticeship schemes. Mm. So that what you can do is to get young people into these companies which are working with these, you know, sort of, you know, with these new jobs, the new economy, so that these are the sort of, you know, skills of tomorrow, which is what they will use. And I think if we get that right and get our education system more exposed to industry, I think that's what we need going forward.
So a micro answer is complete agreement to that last part. In fact, I proposed in the US, which has a student loan issue going on, I have proposed that you hire kids out of vocational training and college, put them through a government program with, say, the CIA or the NSA, where they learn, say, cybersecurity, and companies like us should hire them and waive their student loan as a way of encouraging them to go into this field. That can be adapted to India's circumstances in the form that Dr. Rajiv just said. There's a macro answer, and I'm treading in policy space, so forgive me for that one, because now I might actually give you a sleepless night.
I think once the students have been hired by CIA and NSA, we should hire them in India.
Yeah, exactly.
So we will leave that expertise.
That, by the way, is a different topic. But, but there's a macro answer, which I'll tell you, which is that I believe that digitization is only part of a big picture that this government is painting. What they're really painting is an effort to move people into the formal economy from the informal economy. Without moving people into the formal economy, you cannot improve productivity. Without improving productivity, you cannot get the kind of GDP growth rate and jobs that you need to generate. It is just, it's almost mathematical how that needs to work. Now, digitization is one arrow in the quiver to do this. It's manufacturing, it's skills, it's fixing bank balance sheets, it's democratizing productivity is what technology does.
Correct.
We need to take that on full scale, and to his point, this is not an either or. This is an imperative.
An imperative.
Great. So we will take three questions. I have names already, but I'll try and get you in if we have still some time left. So let me first go to Urvashi Aneja.
Nicely placed next to the mic. Thanks, Samir. I'm Urvashi Aneja from ORF. I was hoping we could kind of turn this conversation a little bit to the intersection between the digital economy and securing the digital economy and the question of social norms, and particularly what that means for women. So recent studies suggest, for an example, that in a lot of tier two and tier three towns, mobile phones are actually shared across families, and the woman does not necessarily have direct access to the mobile phone. There was an example recently. There was a village in Meerut where the Khap Panchayat put a fine of 2,000 rupees on any unmarried woman that was seen using a mobile phone in public. We did a survey in rural Madhya Pradesh recently where we found that while mobile phone subscription amongst women had gone up, the usage was still dominated by men. So most of them did not have the numerical literacy to actually dial a number, leave alone respond to the OTP verification mechanism. Right, so I think what I'm saying with these three examples is that the digital economy can equally exasperate, if not reinforce, if not exasperate, existing gender hierarchies. And of course, for each of these examples, there is a counter example. example of women who have benefited from the digital economy and have used the digital economy as a means for economic inclusion and participation. But I think the question still remains is that how do we make sure that conversations about securing the digital economy take into account exclusionary social norms and practices? So it's not only, I think, a question of access, but existing social structures that are exclusionary. Thank you.
That's a very important question, because both of you have mentioned access.
I have just one point of view. You shouldn't translate the digital economy into mobile phones. That's the first error of thinking that is happening in a lot of places. This is because mobile phone companies, both manufacturers and others, do actually do a pretty good job of providing access as a tool, but don't believe that's the only way. At the end of the day, there are many routes to digital inclusion. And in fact, the fact that India went down the path of collecting biometrics, to me, it's a whole other opportunity of providing digital access to even an illiterate person. And that's the genius of that system. So I think actually I'd encourage all of us to think beyond that. And then a slightly more lighthearted comment. If Saudi Arabia can allow women to drive, it's about time some idiot cup panchayat did not fine them 2,000 rupees for using a mobile phone. That's just social change that needs to happen in India. We shouldn't hold back digital movements for the fact that that's happening. That's a separate issue that needs to be tackled on an emergent basis. And I understand that. I've got two daughters at home and a wife who will kill me if I don't say what I'm saying. So know that I am on your side.
But you know, I mean, two comments, very brief ones. One is that I am convinced that digital technology will help overcome the gender divide. Because, you know, any such powerful technology like this, you know, will certainly go, you know, into breaking the existing social norms, you know, that affect women in adverse ways, in many, many ways. You know, because I mean, if for example tomorrow you got a mobile smartphone and women can watch movies on that which their male counterparts don't like them to watch, I mean, it'll happen. It's just gone. So, you know, technologies are subversive with nature, and this subversion of this male dominated etc. nonsense, you know, will happen with this technology. That's the first thing. And the second one, you know, is that in India, as you know, sort of old quip that whatever you say of India, the opposite is also true. You know, so which is that, you know, why I'm saying that, I've got a mother, 88 years old, who is happily using iPad and doing FaceTiming and all of the rest of it, and, you know, and getting used to it. She hadn't seen talk about smartphone, she's never got, you know, never thought about it. And now she's insisting on getting herself, you know, something like a, you know, digital wallet, because she says, she wants to make use of the, you know, of the online vegetable shopping. You know, that's when that's... So, you know, so there you go.
Cool.
You know, so there you go. So, you know, so rest assured, social norms will not be able to prevent, you know, the women from using this technology. And I'm sure the gender exclusion will not increase because of that, but it will go down as we go forward.
Can I request Vivan to pose a question?
Thank you. This is both Dr. Kumar and Mr. Banga. I'm here. You know, both of you have a lot of experience in regulation and policy making, and have a vantage point of many decades of experience. So you've seen in the banking sector and in digital in the financial services sector, traditional financial services sector, that we now have, we've just created over 5-6 regulators that govern the lives of different financial service providers. We seem to be moving in a similar trajectory as far as digital payments is concerned. We, after demonetization, you know, we gave charge to Niti Aayog to drive some of this, to Meti to drive some of this, and of course the old incumbent RBI continues to drive a lot of policy and regulation around digital payments. How do you resolve the fact that you do need an integrated approach, and perhaps driven by some sort of a high-level policy objective, which is sort of incentive compatible between banks and financial services and all of that, and not lose the nuances of the technical and sectoral issues that an RBI or a METI or others might bring to the table?
So multiplicity of jurisdictions, multiplicity of regulators, in a sense. Does light regulation mean many people interfering with small segments of this chain, or do we need an integrated approach? And can Niti be the place where we discover it?
You know, if by integrated approach you mean a single unified regulator, I'm scared of that in India. So I would rather have, you know, this sort of distributed regulation.
Like you mentioned, single point of failure.
Single point of failure. I mean, so, you know, so
in a different context.
In a different context.
No, but I mean, essentially saying that you need degrees of freedom here. You know, you need degrees of freedom. So I would have different regulators for different, different horses for courses, as it were, and not be very concerned, because I have not seen that happening. You know, the fear about regulatory arbitrage. There is some of it, but I think that can be taken care of in some sense. And as far as digital payment, digital cash, digital payment system is concerned, I would let the RBI handle it as a part of the banking financial sector, and encourage the RBI to develop that expertise, as I said earlier, you know, within it. Because rather than set, you know, at the moment, but at the same time, I would not sort of think about, oh, all this is coming, so I need to wrap in the all the existing regulators into one, because that will not be the way I would work at it. The only other thing that I want to say, that at some stage, when India does grow, you know, sort of, you know, triples its per capita income and grows in size, etc., you might need state-specific regulators in a much bigger way, because the complexity would become so much. And the diversity could become so much that a single regulator for any of the capital markets or the banking sector or you know, the sort of, you know, whatever, you know, insurance sector may not suffice. And maybe you'll have branches of that, or maybe you'll have, we'll think of that model when we cross that bridge.
And the only thing I'd add to that is that there are people here recognize that issue. If you look at the Wattle Committee on Payments, which was put together, it was put together to try and find a way to provide a roadmap which would cross through regulatory hurdles. Something like that, when it gets implemented, now it hasn't yet been implemented, but I've read through it. I actually consider it to be one of the best roadmaps for almost any country to adopt. It's that well written, and it's that well thought through by the people who served on that committee. They've actually done this nation a great service with what they've produced.
So the final intervention this evening is from my friend Femi Osho from Nigeria.
My question, two of my final year undergraduate students, they conducted their project, and they did a form of security analysis of mobile banking apps in Nigeria. They selected 12 banks, and at the end they discovered that virtually all the banks that you could, when we conducted the forensic analysis, that data, personal data of customers that are of significant forensic value were extracted. Now, this is a problem for consumers, and we are talking about securing, you know, our consumers. I want to ask, do we need guidelines that define technical specification for financial institutions on the development of these payment systems?
All yours.
So, two things. One is, actually, I'm glad to see somebody from Nigeria. That is our single biggest effort on financial inclusion, with the identity card that the government's issuing. On the other side is a social benefit distribution card. And it's currently, we've issued 13 million, we're going to 160 million. And that is completely secure, because the data is kept in the government, and what's on the chip is only the ability to translate a 16-digit non-identifiable number protected with a cryptogram that prevents all that PII from leaking out. Now, you've asked a different question as well, which is, do you need standards for how mobile applications work so that PII of personal identifiable information of consumers cannot be accessed? Absolutely. In fact, as I said at the beginning when we were talking about my cybersecurity fears, that multiplies by the fact that all that information is not just on a mobile phone, it will be in your refrigerator. Correct. Which is being empowered to order groceries directly from a internet shopping site. So this thing is going to get worse if we don't get standards going. In fact, to my mind, global interoperable standards on what the Internet of Things needs to subscribe to enable downloading of new patches, security systems, detection of anomalous behavior. If your refrigerator is supposed to talk to your online shopping site, but not to your toaster, you will not know if you don't know the IP address of the two. We need to get this organized. And if we don't, this runway train is leaving the station as we speak. And that to me is why I was saying I would love to give him some sleepless nights, because as a policymaker, he can make a difference beyond what my voice can do.
Thank you. Final word to you as the policymaker.
Well, I just want to say that we've got to accept the reality of the digital world.
Yep.
And I think in India, especially at the state government levels, this has to come much more rapidly than what it has. As Ajay is saying, the train is leaving the station, and we don't want to be left behind. But I find that there is a little bit of inertia here in the government circles, and things are sort of left to themselves. And it will be because Niti has been charged to do this, and Niti has been made the focal point for pushing the digital agenda forward. I think you will find Niti very active in this as we go along, and we will make sure that the digital economy is one place where India is ahead of the curve, or at least along the curve, and not be running behind it.